Welcome to a Songs at the Center Master Series Edition featuring John Oates.
Welcome to Songs at the Center. I'm Eric Nesda. In this show, we're going to take a departure from our usual format of a songwriter round because recently we had the special opportunity to sit down with John Oates, a member of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. We talked songwriting, and he sang us some of his music. We're in for a real treat in what we're calling the Master Series.
Support for Songs at the Center is provided by The Basement Doctor. From top to bottom, fixed to finished, The Basement Doctor has been on the job since 1987, serving Ohio homeowners, and proud to support live original music in Central Ohio and across the country. France & Associates. Established in 1973, France & Associates is a full-service agency offering a variety of professional insurance products and services to Central Ohio, and proud to be a longtime supporter of the Columbus arts community.
We're at Sonic Lounge Studios in Grove City, Ohio, and Songs at the Center is privileged to welcome a Rock and Roll Hall of Famer, a member of the American Songwriters Hall of Fame, and one half of the duo, which has sold more records than any other duo in history, Mr. John Oates. John, thanks for joining us.
Nice to be here, Eric.
Since the Hall & Oates years, you've been very, very busy still.
Yes.
And
the Hall & Oates years continue, by the way.
That's true.
They've never really stopped.
That's right. But you've said that all along, even in the midst of your great success in pop music, that you felt there was something deeper, that there were other things that you wanted to express, mm-hmm. both musically and personally. And that's really been the journey since Hall & Oates, hasn't it?
Well, you know, the success of Hall & Oates has been, obviously the greatest thing. You know, it's changed my life completely on so many levels. But at the same time, you know, you become identified with, you become part of something, and that is that can also sometimes be a creative burden. Not that negatively, because I'm sure a lot of people would hope for that to have a problem like that. But what it's done really for me is provided the ability for me to express myself now as a solo artist, which I've been doing for about 12 years now, and tap back into the roots of the music that made me want to be a musician and a singer and a songwriter and a guitar player way back when I was a kid, way back before I even met Daryl. So now that's become really, it's almost going back to the beginning to go forward.
Well, we'd love it if you'd kick us off with something
sure.
you'd like to play, and I'll let you introduce it.
Okay, well, I'd like to start with this, with a traditional blues that takes me back to my childhood. One of my favorite performers back in the day was Mississippi John Hurt, for a number of reasons. One, I loved his guitar style. I loved his sly humor, sense of humor. I saw him perform many times at the Second Fret and the Main Point in Philadelphia and at the Philadelphia Folk Festival. And he also was... he used to sleep on the sofa of my guitar teacher when he came to town because, of course, he couldn't afford a hotel. And so I would literally sit in the living room and watch him play.
Wow.
And I had a great experience to be at the right place at the right time. So I'll do a Mississippi John version of a classic, the classic Stagger Lee story, which he called Stacko Lee. And I'll do it kind of in his style.
Great.
Officer, now how can that be? You can arrest everybody, but you're afraid of Stagger Lee. He's a bad man, cruel old Stagger Lee. Billy DeLion told Stagger Lee, now please don't take my life. I got three children and a darling, lovely wife. You bad man, cruel old Stagger Lee. I don't care about your children, I don't care about your wife. No, no, you done stole my Stetson hat, now I'm gonna take your life. I'm a bad man. I said, boom, boom, boom. the sharp ability line down upon a barroom floor. Now he's a bad man who holds Staggerly. Well, the judge said to the jury, hey boys, what are you gonna think of that? Staggerly sharp ability line, about a $5 lesson hat. He's a bad man who holds Staggerly. Up on the gallows, Staggerly did fuss and cuss. Judge said, boys, better hang him now before he kills the rest of us. He's a bad man, cruel old Staggerly. He's a bad man, cruel old Staggerly.
Well, you work in a variety of configurations. You work as a solo artist, and then you have a band and trios and duos and everything else.
Yeah, yeah.
And I know that you've played at the Bluebird Cafe down in Nashville as a solo artist.
A few times, yeah.
And, you know, I personally feel that a song that comes off with just a voice and one instrument, that when it works that way, you know it's a solid song.
I like you, Eric, because I'm totally in agreement with you.
Thank you.
For real. No, it's absolutely, it's the acid test. If you can sit down and play your song with no accompaniment and no production and no frills needed to pull it off, then that's what it's all about. It shows you that the composition itself has integrity and it's for real.
Right, yeah. And then there's always the conflict of when you're demoing it. Do you leave space in it? Do you make it simple, just a voice and a guitar, so that the producer then can take it where he or she wants it, or do you dress it up the way you want it? And that's always, I guess that depends on the song a lot, right?
Yeah, it depends on a lot of things. That's an interesting point, which I don't think the average person even thinks about. When a songwriter demos a song, sometimes it's better to flesh it out and realize it in a little bit of a more finished way so that prospective artists or record companies can hear it. And sometimes they don't necessarily have the best imaginations, so sometimes it's better to lay it out for them. And other times, it's better to, as you said earlier, to leave it very stark and bare bones so that a producer and or artist can reimagine it in their own way.
Right.
So it's a fine line between that. I've done songs both ways, where I've demoed them just in a simple guitar and voice style, and then actually done it with a rhythm section and fleshed it out. So that way people have to, you know, you never know who you're dealing with. And
right.
If you're trying to sell a song to someone else, sometimes that's a good approach.
Right. And so a good song can also be arranged in a whole lot of different ways, in different styles. And I know that you've kind of worked up a different take on Maneater.
I've worked up many different takes on Maneater. Maneater started out as a reggae song.
Really?
Yeah, I had gone to Jamaica on a little holiday and came back, and I just had reggae in my head. And I came up with the chorus for Maneater in a total reggae style.
Huh.
It was something like this. It was like, she come, watch out boy, she gonna chew you up, oh here she come. And I thought it was pretty cool, and Daryl and I got together and I played it for him, and he went, this is his exact words, which I thought was very funny. He said, Hall & Oates don't do reggae. As if he and I weren't sitting in the same room together, which was kind of funny. And I said, well, what do you got in mind? He goes, let's make it like a Motown song. He goes, check this out. And he came up with a boom, 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 ba-da-da-da-da-dum, boom, boom. And obviously, I'm really glad I listened to him because obviously it became a huge hit. And so that just shows you how a song can morph, you know, in the songwriting process stage. Years have gone by. I haven't played that song a million times. You know, when we play it with the Hall & Oates band, of course, we play it very true to the recording. In that kind of Motown stompy kind of style. But over the years, you know, people, I play solo, as you said, at the Bluebird in various configurations, and people go, oh, play Maneater, or they'll shout out various hits that they want to hear. And I realized I just didn't want to try to replicate Hall & Oates without Daryl. That's stupid. You know, I there's no point in that. And so I said, let me figure out a way of changing this around. Mm. I could have played it in a reggae style, but instead I decided to try to do it a little bit more of a Delta blues type of style.
Oh, neat.
Just because I can, I guess.
Great.
Should I give it a shot?
Yeah. So many ways to do a great song. Thanks for sharing that
sure.
with us.
Yeah.
Well, you write with a lot of different people in Nashville, and, mm-hmm. and you seem to have a particularly good chemistry, though, with Jim Lauderdale.
I do.
And you love to write those songs with him at night.
Jim and I have our midnight writing sessions, and it's so much fun. We do imbibe a little bit. I will be honest about that. And we usually do our best work when everyone else is sleeping. There's something magical about that. I don't know. But we have a great time. He's one of the funniest human beings on earth. So he keeps me laughing, and we always write something unique. We've written swing songs together. We've written songs that sound like country songs. We've written blues. We've written rock songs. This one particular that I'd like to play is a song that's very unique. I wanted to write something that sounded primitive, and I told Jim that. I said, Jim, I said, there's a guitar style that dates back to the Carter family, and when I was a kid, it was one of the first folky kind of things that I learned, and I've never been able to incorporate that into a more contemporary song. And I thought, if we can reach back to that that very unusual, unique style, maybe we can write a song that's a little bit more contemporary but has the flavor of a really old, primitive Appalachian traditional song. And he, you know, of course, Jim, being from North Carolina, jumped right on board with that. And we came up with this song, and we wrote it quite quickly, and I just love it. It's just a very gentle, really, to me, it reminds me of the best of the kind of Southeast American styles. So,
would you be kind enough to play it for us?
I would love to.
Okay, all great. Right. And the name of this is?
Oh, this is When Carolina Comes Home Again. Summer is over. Frost in the field. Something unbroken, something so real. Now I want to live in the love we had then. When Carolina comes home again. Time always teaches, seasons renew. Mountains and beaches, I walked with you. Our road is a story without any end. Oh, Carolina, come home. I can still feel you laying so close. Look for a lifeline after you go. It's what I hold on to hard as I can. Oh, Carolina, come home. In the letters, love that we made, thoughts that we wrote with never will fade. What's left behind us is the love we had then. Oh, Carolina, come home again. When Carolina comes home. When Carolina comes home again.
That's a gorgeous song.
Thanks.
Thanks for sharing that.
Thanks,
with
Jim.
Us. One of the songs that you wrote with Nathan Chapman is Pushing a Rock Uphill.
Yeah.
And you've talked about this journey of yours as, you know, coming home and the fact that as a pop writer, you always want to dig a little deeper. This mm-hmm. is an inspirational song.
Yes, it is.
And there's a beautiful line in there, we can reach around the world if we just reach out to each other.
Mm-hmm.
Does that really encapsulate what your living philosophy is and what you want your music to do?
Well, I'm makes me very happy that you identified that line in particular and that song in general. That song really came from a very important place. To talk about the line, yes, I do believe that you know, you try to make, if you want to make a big statement, start by making a personal statement. And hopefully that can grow into something more universal. I think when you make something personal, not only is it more relatable to other people, but it has a power that of conviction and heart and soul that you believe in. And then that can hopefully transfer on a more universal and a wider and broader level.
Yeah, and one of the rewards of being a songwriter is that people, strangers, will open their lives up to you mm-hmm. when they hear something that's been that's touched them.
And they will also somehow, they will also relate their own personal experience to the song itself and the meaning of the song, even though it may not be what the songwriter intended.
Exactly.
And that's the beauty of the songwriting process. It's really, really a cool part of it.
Well, and that's the beauty and the magic of this song. So will you share it with us?
Absolutely. All right. Pushing a rock uphill. Here we go. Feels like I'm pushing a rock uphill, and I can't do a thing about it. Feel like I'm pushing a rock uphill, never, never, never gonna give up. Hey there, brother, can you lend a man a hand? We're both hurting, and I know that you'll understand. Don't wanna beg or borrow, yeah, it kills my pride. I'm just doing what I got to do to make it out of here alive. Feel like I'm pushing a rock uphill, and I can't do a thing about it. Feel like I'm pushing a rock uphill, never, never, never gonna give it up. No, like I'm pushing a rock uphill, and when it starts to roll back down, just roll with it. Oh, oh, oh. Oh, just roll with it. So I know I'll get back on my feet again, and I'll be checking on you, my faithful friend. Are we gonna get through this thing one way or another? We can reach around the world if we just reach out to each other. Yeah, I feel like I'm pushing the rock uphill, and I can't do a thing about it. Feel like I'm pushing a rock uphill, oh, never, never, never gonna give it up. Feel like I'm pushing a rock uphill, and when it starts to roll back down, just roll with it. Oh yeah, just roll with it. Oh, baby, when the road gets too rough, yeah, how much can you take when enough is enough? When life comes down hard, baby, are you gonna walk away? Keep on pushing it every day. Feels like I'm pushing a rock uphill, and I can't do a thing about it. Feel like I'm pushing a rock uphill, oh, never, never, never gonna get up. Feel like I'm pushing a rock uphill, and when it starts to roll back and down, just roll with it, roll with it, roll, roll. Oh yeah, just roll with it. Feels like I'm pushing a rock uphill. 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 And when it starts to roll back down, just roll. Just roll.
road.
It's great. Thank you so much.
Thanks, man.
Well, John Oates, it's just been an honor for me to spend some time with you, and
thanks,
a pleasure for our audience.
Well, you're a good interviewer. I appreciate that.
Well, thank you. We just cannot thank you enough for coming by and being good. So generous with your time and your music. So,
thanks, man.
Best of luck. Hope to see you again soon.
I hope so, too.
All right. Thank you.
This program is made possible in part by The Basement Doctor. From top to bottom, fixed to finished, The Basement Doctor has been on the job since 1987, serving Ohio homeowners, and proud to support live original music in Central Ohio and across the country. France & Associates. Established in 1973, France & Associates is a full-service agency offering a variety of professional insurance products and services to Central Ohio, and proud to be a longtime supporter of the Columbus arts community. Closed captioning for Songs at the Center is provided by Custom Air.